time for the Gore N More podcast.
Gonna have a good time.
Gonna have a good time.
Yeah, we're gonna have a good time.
We're going on now.
A ball break, walking hand in hand
in the moonlight.
We'll be the sweet soul there. I swear, we'll never part.
We're going on now.
A ball break, running in the sand, feeling alright.
And what's up, everybody, and welcome to the Gore N More podcast. This is your host with the motherfucking most, TJ Bowser, and joining me as always, your Dark Lord of Knowledge, Chad Chrisman.
What's up, bitches?
And Big Johnny D.
What's going on, Gorehounds?
And the killing machine himself, Bobby Amone.
What's killing, motherfuckers?
So today is December 16th, 2019, and we got a juicy holiday one for you. But before that, it's time for the Slice of Life. What do we got today, Johnny?
Oh, nice easy week of work, and let's begin the countdown before Christmas break. I got the rest of this week and next Monday, and then I'm break for fucking 11 days, dude, and I can't wait.
Must be nice.
Yeah, I can agree with that.
As soon as I get out of work that last day, right in my car, I turn off the alarm on my phone, and that is just such a nice feeling. But let's see, what fun shit did I do this week? I went DVD diving at the dollar store, picked up some sweet little, what did I get? Chillerama and Wolf Cop.
Woo! My buddy worked on Wolf Cop.
Yeah, for a buck, dude. So I was like, fuck yeah, man. Can't beat that shit. And then played a little bit more Resident Evil 7. So yeah. And then, Resident Evil 7 is just getting nastier and nastier. I beat, like, the first main guy. It was fucking awesome. All I'm going to say is Chainsaw Fight. That's all I got to say. I don't want to go anymore because I don't want to spoil anything for anybody who hasn't seen shit. Then let's see. Sunday, I got dragged to Disney on Ice.
Yeah.
How was that experience?
I made it out with outspending more than $100, so I'm gonna
nice.
That is a positive.
So you bought like what, two t-shirts?
Bro, not even that. So oh my god, so the wife and I were actually, so two boxes of popcorn is $20, so it's $10 a pop. So the girl, when she brought it over and it was in the box at the top of her head, we counted out, dude, there was like $400 worth of popcorn sitting on top of her head, and I'm like, fucking Disney, dude, like holy shit.
Yeah.
And yeah, it was, you know, and I convinced the daughter, I was like, hey, remember you got last year? Yeah. I was like, let daddy put some new batteries in it so it's nice and good. Okay. I'm like, yeah, because they're going to have the same wand there anyway.
That's awesome.
They did.
All right.
She still ended up leaving with a doll. So I still got fucked out of $30 there.
Like, you got caught, boy.
And then the best was, the cotton candy, dude, because she was like, oh, cotton candy. All right. So the guy comes over. All right, we'll take one cotton candy. Cool. Do you want a hat or a crown? And I was like, what? He's like, you want a hat or a crown? I was like, I just want the cotton candy. He's like, no, it comes with it. I was like, oh, the crown? He's like, okay, $18. I'm like,
Jesus Christ.
He's like, you
I was
assholes.
Waiting for something to go along with that.
But yeah, I will say, they definitely sneak a few little things in there to keep the dads interested, dude, of cheerleaders in the beginning.
Hey,
they had Ariel doing pole dancing at 50 feet in the air. That was pretty interesting.
All of a sudden,
real quick, for the Gorehounds and the shit show, the counter starts now. Continue.
But yeah, other than that, got out of there, relaxed, then watched another movie that I would like to talk about at the end of the podcast. So I'm going to switch it over to Bobby, man. How was your week?
It's been an interesting week. But it was a busy weekend. I worked. I had dinner with my friend Lisa on Saturday night. We were discussing more photo shoots and such as well. And then yesterday was my grandmother's birthday, so we were celebrating that at her house. And I ended up with a poison ivy attack. So my
poison ivy
is
attack.
I was cutting up roots because we were rebuilding a building at the farm, and nobody told me it was poison ivy. So I found out later the hard way. And so my eye is all fucking swollen. I look like fucking Quasimodo. Other than that, everything's all right. Life is good. I got no complaints.
You still look handsome as ever. Chad?
Who paid you? Yes, Chad, you're next.
Well, all I did was work, and this weekend, had a lazy weekend. My wife went and had a little get-together with her friends, so it was me and the kids Saturday night. We watched some Star Wars. But we only got halfway through the first movie because my son was starting to fall asleep, so we got to finish that.
That happens sometimes.
And I finally beat the main storyline for Spider-Man.
Spider-Man!
And the funny story about that is the fucking game and the final battle with Dr. Octopus glitched on me three fucking times. And I had to restart it every time. And it was glitching the exact same part. It was when you're fighting Doc Ock and he goes up onto the tower and he starts to... He breaks the tower and sends all the electricity down. And then he just he would just go limp and stay there. And I couldn't do anything to him. Three fucking times in a row.
I say, aren't you supposed to like throw something at him at
that
point?
Yeah, and I did that. And then he just went limp and I couldn't do anything.
Went limp, huh?
Yeah.
That's a personal issue.
I'm assuming you watched all the end credits and all the extra good fucking post-credit scenes and bullshit like that.
And like I said, the one part really ripped the fucking heart out of my chest. I told you about that.
What part was it, Chad?
When his aunt died.
Bastard!
That's pretty much all I can say to that one.
Yeah, that was pretty rough. And
but no, I like the way that they're going with Ultimate.
It's definitely Ultimate, right? Venom. But there's
That's what I was thinking, because if they're going that route, which I hope, if they're still going in that, they'll go with Agent Venom eventually, which would be fucking dope. Maybe. I don't know,
because we haven't seen Flash Thompson, so if they go Agent Venom, it's gonna be somebody else.
Well, they could always introduce him in the second game, you know? I mean, but
that might be a little bit too much too soon.
How have we not talked Ghostbusters yet?
Well,
we're getting there. We're talking.
Okay, there's a good reason.
We're getting there.
We're talking.
No. There's a good reason for that, and I will say I stopped myself last time because I didn't personally want to just take over the hour and a half fucking podcast just talking about a 2-minute Ghostbuster trailer.
Well, this is something that you need to record by yourself.
We could have done that.
Well, yeah,
we could do a bonus one
by myself, dude.
But anyhow,
John, we could do this for 2 hours. Trust me, I was listening to some stuff today about it. But we'll go.
Okay, so getting back to the Spider-Man game, like I said, it sets up Ultimate Venom. And I still say, from what the way they handled Dr. Octopus with his nerve condition and everything, I think it's possible they're setting up a Superior Spider-Man.
I guess I'll have to read Superior Spider-Man, because I know, like, I thought it was Ultimate, he still goes into, like, that husk form because his body goes to shit.
No. The Ultimate Spider-Man was Dr. Octopus took over Peter's body.
Ah.
And eventually they came to agreement that Ock would leave and Spider-Man and Peter Parker would take over, because he realized that Peter was the Superior Spider-Man after all.
So it was Superior that he became that, like, husk form where he just, like, it was just the arms that moved him around?
Pretty much, yeah.
Because I know there was a part, like, he died after that, and then they, like, brought him back, like, they revived him to, like, his, like, normal human, like, full, like, 100% health state. Like,
yeah, it got a bit weird.
That's Hall of Heroes. Yeah, that's a way fucking farther bullshit, dude. But no, man, that's awesome. I'm glad you enjoyed the game, dude.
Yeah, it was great. Now I'm going through the downloadable content, all the different little side missions there.
Hell yeah, man.
TJ. I just want to throw this out there real quick, just because this is really cool. Last night, we're sitting there watching whatever Gingerbread Showdown, whatever the fuck it is, on Food Network.
Okay.
And it was the semifinal, and their thing was they had to do, their theme was basically just Santa on vacation. Okay, that has nothing to do with this. So the person that won moved on to the final, and the final is next week, and the theme is Gremlins.
No shit.
Yeah.
What day does that air?
It'll be Sunday night at 9.
I'm staying up late, bitch.
Fuck yeah, dude.
So yeah, I thought that was really cool. Okay, so
I just found out about Christmas Light Fights, man. That show is fucking ridiculous. No?
Never heard of it.
Nothing. No, never heard of it.
Okay, nope. So take us with our enthusiasm with horror.
Uh-huh.
These people, it's a contest. You can win $50,000.
Oh, that's a lot of money.
So they go fucking ham with Christmas decorations, dude. Like,
They cook the ham or the Christmas decorations?
Generators and shit, dude. Like,
no, you know who does come for the ham?
Who?
Guy Fieri.
Ah, Flavor Town, baby. One-way trip.
You guys have no idea. Well, when I got here, he was looking for Flavor Town sound bites.
Yeah?
Yeah, he's going to add to the soundboard.
You.
So besides looking for that, what else did you do this week there, buddy?
Well, I got a new Power Rangers game, the Shattered Grid. It's like Marvel versus Capcom, but with the Power Rangers. I don't know why you want to say Star Wars, because they dropped one of those trailers today. Anyway, getting off of topic there. But anyway,
I'm going to assume, wasn't that good?
Yeah. I recorded an episode with Mick. We talked about him doing Quiet Cool, which is an anti-pop movie from the late 80s. And him working on that. And I'm telling you what, this prop humor is just fitting really well with me. And
that soundboard is great.
Great soundboard, guys. So, and then Sunday, didn't do a whole hell of a lot. Played a lot of video games. Played that Power Rangers game, a little bit of Jedi Fallen Order, a little bit of Ghost Recon Wildlands, and of course, Toy Soldiers. I have the Toy Chest one, and it's incredible. It's all the games smashed into one, and I got all the DLC, so I get to play as G.I. Joe and Cobra, and those are the best. So other than that, today, watched this insane fucking movie once again. It was a wonderful treat. Yes. My daughter's Christmas presents came in today, and since she's not here, I can talk about them. I got her a Sony Cybershot H300 camera. I got her a newer camera bag. It has a purple inside and a heavy-duty tripod from newer that attaches to the side of the camera bag.
Nice.
So it's all one big cohesive unit. It's really nice. The camera's really nice. Good starter camera. And awesome is I think it took the 128 gigabyte card that I put in there. So I don't think she's running out anytime soon. And it looks like it takes AAA batteries. So I can just get her a rechargeable pack and call it a week, you know?
Mm-hmm. That's what I forgot to mention. Some Christmas presents came in for some people as well today. But apparently a few people wanted my Jason figure, so I had to go get some for them too as well. So
that was Do you sign them?
if you want.
Okay.
You have to say you want it. If not, I don't.
Now,
I
do you sign them Bobby or Killing Machine?
Or do you just mushroom stamp
it? Then mushroom stamp.
Yeah.
You caught me, John. I mushroom stamped that bitch.
Just smack that thing on ink.
Just the mushroom tip on the stamp, like on like the ink, and then just smack it down real quick.
Slap it on the pen, slap it on the paper.
I slap it down like, you know, a piece of meat.
Oh my god. Greta. Oh, okay. So enough about Bobby's penis.
I forgot.
Today we are going to 2005 Santa Sleigh, directed by David Steinman, written by David Steinman, produced by Sammy Lee Bray, Brett Ratner, Doug Steeman, starring Douglas Smith as Nicholas Yulson, Bill Goldberg as Santa Claus, Emily DeRaven as Mary McKenzie, Robert Culp. Is he related to Stephen Culp?
I have no idea.
Check that for me. As Grandpa Dave Thomas, as Pastor Timmons, Saul Rubinick as Mr. Green, James Caan as Darren Mason, uncredited, Rebecca Gayhart as Gwen Mason, Chris Kattan as Jason Mason, Sam real quick there, but goddamn, what a cameo, Fran Drescher as Virginia Mason, another great cameo, music by Henning Launer, cinematography by Matthew F. Leonetti, edited by Stephen Pavel. Palavaca? Fuck that name. Julia Wong, distributed by Media 8 Entertainment, released December 20th, 2005. Runtime of 78 wonderful, hilarious minutes. Budget, the fuck if we know. Gross, the fuck if we know. Trailer, roll that.
Beautiful bean footage.
Grandpa, I want the truth about Christmas.
If it's the truth you want, then it's the scary truth you're gonna have.
According to the Book of Claus, Santa, Satan's only son, lost a bet and was forced to spread Christmas cheer. But now, all bets are off.
Oh my God! Santa?
Yes, there is a Santa Claus.
Santa Claus is not a myth or a legend. He's real. Only he's not bearing gifts and presents anymore.
Christmas can sure scare the dickens out of people.
He's scary yet educational.
I'm just trying to spread little Yuletide fear.
Are you saying Santa is offing everyone who's naughty and nice?
Nicholas shot him!
You shot Santa?
This holiday season.
Ho, ho, ho.
Lock your doors. Bolt the windows.
Oh, Grandpa got run over by a reindeer.
Everyone stand back. Things are about to get a little messy.
And block the chimney. Cause naughty or nice, Santa Claus is coming to town. Santa's sleigh.
Go ahead, kids. Let's see what Santa got you.
I hate children.
What a fucking trailer and what a fucking movie. So who's going to do a plot?
I like how the movie is a horror movie, but that trailer is just fun, funny, happy music. And all this chaos in the background.
Yes.
It's wonderful.
That is, it describes the movie. It's a perfect trailer for the movie. Who's doing the plot rundown of this sexy beast?
I'll do it. I haven't done it for a while.
Okay, Chad.
It
turns out that Santa Claus is not really the cuddly, harmless old fellow that we all know and love. In fact, he's a devil. And the only thing that has been keeping his bad side in check all this time is a bet he lost with an angel. Now the bet has expired, and 1,000 years of good cheer will be replaced by Christmas fear. This Christmas will be a violent night of chaos with Santa bashing his way through town. Local boy Nicholas, his girlfriend Mac, and his crazy grandfather are the only ones who know the truth about Santa and can save their town and the world.
Ho, ho, ho.
That sounded more like the weird, creepy Santa from Christmas Story.
Right, that's what I was thinking. I can instantly just see the fucking boot press. Like,
you'll shoot your eye out. Ho, ho, ho.
Merry Christmas.
Nice.
Continue.
Fuck yeah, dude.
So that's the plot rundown. Let's talk about it, guys. As we all realize that we all really love this movie... Which is...
Should I take the front, seeing it was my pick?
Oh, take it, Daddy. Take it.
All right. So, originally, I saw this movie when it came back out in 2005.
Uh-huh.
Back in the good old Blockbuster days of when you're just cycling through whatever, and you're just, like, looking at the covers, and you're like, yeah, that looks cool. And, yeah, man, you know, just wandering, and all of a sudden, you just come upon, and you're like, Bill Goldberg as Santa Claus. And I'm like, well, who the fuck doesn't want to watch that?
Right.
And
it's gold right there.
Let me say, I enjoyed it the first time, and I haven't watched it since until I just watched it this week for this review. And oh my God, man, like I'm totally throwing it back in my rotation for Christmas movies because I woke my family up because I watched it too early. And I woke them up because I was laughing so fucking loud. I got the chime in on the Alexa from my wife and I was like, hey, what's up? She's like, shut the fuck up. We're trying to sleep. And I'm like, I'm sorry. Like instantaneous laughter as soon. Like, I mean, I was laughing during the whole family scene, dude. But as soon as he comes down and punks that fucking dog, dude.
Oh, my God.
And this movie, like, just from that,
it never chills.
Bit, It has a little bit of a lull at the end, but oh my god, dude, like this movie just like it's almost nonstop. And it's
Biker Santa's my favorite laughter. Though, like
at the very end with the plane.
It's like if Lloyd Kaufman and Mel Brooks had a baby and then they left that baby on an orphanage on Christmas.
It's a hell of a way to compare it.
I like it.
I mean, it's not the caliber of Brooks by any means, and it's not to the level of Kaufman, but it's like somewhere in that weird in between spot. Like
it's there.
That is a very, very accurate way of describing it too.
Yeah, I kind of thought about it today and I was like, that's kind of where I would put it in that category. Like, it's not so on par of like, you know, any of the fucking trauma movies or shit like that, but it is ridiculous enough to be there. But fucking what I want to hear what you guys thought, man. Like,
oh, it's so perfect.
I was able to convince my wife to watch, and I think she really got a kick out of it. I said, you're going to like this. I said, it's dumb.
Uh-huh.
But it's like, it's dumb in a fun way. You're really going to love it. And she did. She liked it.
Bobby?
I was watching on the laptop earlier today. And my dad says, so what are you guys talking about tonight on the podcast? I said, we're talking about a movie where Bill Goldberg plays Santa. It's called Santa Sleigh. He just started laughing. He's like, oh God.
Like, did he watch it? Like,
no, the moment this movie started, I had a smile on my face. And I saw the first kill, and I'm like,
okay,
this is going to be wonderful.
If this means anything, but mostly means more to us here, Taryn said that this movie is freaking awesome.
That's great.
The movie is, it was wonderful. It was a laugh. It had graphic, and Bill Goldberg as Santa was the fucking shit.
Like, I actually started off that I was going to write down every kill, and I'm glad I didn't waste time doing that because I looked it up. There's 41 kills in this movie.
One more than
Holy
Vengeance.
Shit.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's really hard when you get to the strip club because there's like so many people in the background and shit. And like,
you
really have to like pause it and count it and shit like that.
And that's exactly what I didn't want to do, was pause it just to get caught up. I just want to watch the fucking movie.
Yeah. Nobody wants to do that.
I did do that because there was just a few like things that I just had to take notes where I was just like laughing so hard. I was like, all right, hold on, wait,
yeah,
stop. Like, okay. But TJ, this wasn't your first viewing, correct?
No, this would be my second viewing of this film. I watched it earlier in life. Can't remember when, but I know I watched it. Everything was like a really vague dream. It was good, though. Very fucking hilarious. Got a lot of belly laughs out of me. And of course, me being the wrestling fan that I am, it was nice to see old Bill Goldberg, the man with the streak from WCW, just was incredible. It definitely was a trip and a half. And it was funny. The laughs were the whole way through. The pacing was really well done. The comedy was spot on. And the practical effects were there. I mean, it doesn't get much better than that, and the story was just perfectly shitty enough.
Well, yeah, when you have a pro wrestler playing Santa Claus.
Is that one of those Necronomicons?
Is
that the Necronomicon?
Oh, that was so wonderful.
So, Bobby, you said this was your first viewing, correct?
Yes, this was my first viewing of this, and I loved it. I just fucking loved this movie, all right? I didn't think I was going to love it as much as I ended up loving it.
I
was wrong.
And Chad, I can go with, you've seen this probably a few times.
Yes, I've seen it. It's been a long time. So I think the last time I saw it was on Sci-Fi Channel. So it's
good. I'm glad everybody either had to dust it off a little bit for themselves, or Bobby, it was the first time. Yeah, man, I don't know. This was kind of like a gem. I kind of wish I did it. I held back so long, dude. Like, I fucking laughed my ass off.
So did I. There were so many good lines.
It's on the cusp, I will say.
Ooh, the cusp.
I mean, it is horror. You know what I mean? It's still a slasher, but they already know. You know, it's a horror comedy. They write it on their sleeve. And the fact that it has goddamn Doug McKenzie in it, dude.
Like, yeah. As a crooked filthy preacher.
He played such a good fucking, just corrupt pastor. No, they don't want change. They need bills. Oh, fuck, dude. So, Chad, what do you got for notes on this
piece, boy.
Well, there's not a whole lot of behind-the-scenes stuff on it.
I didn't figure there probably was.
It's a little bit sparse. Right? Yeah, it was direct-to-DVD.
A little bit sparse.
I think it was...
I remember Bill Goldberg coming back at WWE during this time, and he had a... He came out... I think it was maybe a pay-per-view. He came out of the crowd, and he had a Santa sleigh hat on, and he speared somebody, but I can't remember which one he did.
Nice.
Yeah, it was cool.
It was.
I could probably.
I would say back then it was probably Brock Lesnar.
Yep, it was Brock Lesnar.
So I will say, without even like seeing Chad's notes, I probably already know in my head what his main notes are going to be.
All right. So the old book that explains the origin of Santa Claus is written in Icelandic, and some believe that parts of the Santa Claus mythos are taken from Norse legends. Santa Claus is venerated as a saint by several Christian denominations as Saint Nicholas. Ironically, Bill Goldberg, who portrays Santa, is an observant Jew, even going so far as to famously refusing to work on the Jewish high holidays during both his football and wrestling career. Go ahead.
That right there, I think, is one joke that just is huge. Like, unless you are a wrestling fan, or at least you know a little bit about Bill Goldberg, like, that's one huge joke that's just straight off the bat.
Yeah.
Like, oh, this Jewish guy is Santa Claus.
that's another thing that's in my notes. Basically, all the main characters are played by Jewish people.
What was it? Mr. Green? His deli there?
Yeah.
Killed by the menorah.
So, not just like side note, but that whole like, it definitely wasn't my favorite scene, but that whole like where the cops came, dude, and it was just like, wow. Something isn't kosher in here.
No. The better line.
As if that wasn't supposed to.
The better line was right after that, because before they ran into the rabbis.
Yes, yes.
And they're walking out. He's like, hey, round up those Amish folks, too.
That whole scene, dude, like, I made notes. I was just like, I didn't notice it until I paused it, and I looked up, and I was like, holy shit, dude, he's got bagels hanging in the fucking window. Oh, dude, like, this movie is straight up 2005 humor.
And it was perfect.
It's amazing.
It still stands up to this day.
Yes, it does.
Okay, so after the end credits, Santa is seen looking over his naughty list. When he looks into the camera and says, who's next? During his wrestling career, Goldberg made that his catchphrase after pinning his opponents.
What he said.
I know that everybody was waiting Who's for next? Him to say it in the movie, and they at least gave it to you at the end of the credits. So.
Yeah.
The name of the movie was actually the name of a movie within a movie in Ernest Saves Christmas.
Yes.
Yes, it was.
Really?
Uh-huh. Yes, it was. I knew that was going to come up.
Oh, that's one I should watch, man. I haven't watched that since I was a kid.
Oh, it's on demand for free. It is worth
it. It's on demand.
I haven't seen that since it was in theaters, dude.
I love that movie so much.
Ernest Goes to Camp is pretty good, too.
I love Ernest Goes to Camp. I watched that so many times when I was a kid, dude.
Ernest Scared Stupid. Like, come on.
Okay, Robert Culp has also previously appeared in another Christmas horror film. TJ, you better know this one.
Black Christmas.
Silent Night, Deadly Night 3.
Ow. Yeah.
Yeah. To all listeners who want to know what that sound was, TJ missed a stroke.
I did.
TJ.
I pulled up too quick. I'm sorry. Anyway, Bobby, what time is it?
What time? It is 6:48.
No. I know what time it is. Oh.
Bobby fucked up.
Hello there, creepy girls. Do you like spooky things in horror movies? Cabin 13 has the stuff for you. Check out their selection of horror-themed props, pins, busts, action figures, collectibles, and more. You can find them on Facebook and Instagram. Be sure to visit cabin13.com and buy something, or I'll kill you! Marcio Charlie's Horror Costume Studios. Premium hand-sculpted latex masks, busts, and hoods. Everything is handmade and painted by Marcio himself. Be sure to check out his wide range and selection of products over at Facebook and Instagram at Horror Costume Studios. Hey, you out there. Hey, listener. Take a look at yourself. Want to know why you look like shit? Because you aren't wearing Dewback merch. Take your ugly ass over to DewbackDiscussion.net and click on the merch tab.
Pick up some hot fucking swag, then you can become a sexual tyrannosaurus, just like us.
Giggity.
Graveyard Classics. Horror-themed tees and posters, professional in-house screen printing, and jaclay prints. Powered by Death Style Art and Graphics. Go see what you can dig up over at graveyardclassics.net.
Come on down to Mask by Lance. Premium Friday the 13th custom-made hockey mask. Down there in Tennessee by Lance McKinney. Find him on Facebook and Instagram over at Mask by Lance. Go order one now, boy. Yee-hoo!
Speaking of hockey masks, I recently bought a hockey mask this past Friday, for obvious reasons, from Rod Lane over at betteroffdead.net. I got a End Scene Freddy versus Jason Bloody Hawk for a bust that I am making with Brandon Scott Murphy from Sculptor Die, making the Jethro head that goes down into the little quarter thing there. Nice. So I'll have a Freddy versus Jason thing going on.
I
also have a hockey mask coming from one of our sponsors that we just heard from that I won a contest on, and that Jason Goes to Hell posted. It sits behind me. It is the chrome mask that I chose out of his thing. That is coming this week.
Nice. That's the one you went with?
That is the one right there. Yep. Hell so yeah, thank dude. You. So, Mr. Lance McKinney, if you listen to this, thank you very much and I everything for it. I am looking forward to
every episode. And that's what he sounds like, too, by the way.
Hey, I also didn't look. Did anybody see who won the Cabin 13 giveaway this weekend?
I have not.
I didn't see it either.
I didn't even know any of this shit was going on because I don't even have my Facebook anymore. So
yeah,
they made four little miniature Clark Griswold on the saucer ornaments, dude.
Like no way.
With the hood. Oh, dude, it was fucking
damn. I'm sorry, I missed out on that.
And it was they said it was a one off too. So I was just fuck.
Dale sculpted that fucking thing so fast,
dude. It looks so good.
It looked wicked.
He's truly a master.
When they said they were gonna give a prize out, that's what my question was. I was like, yo, tell me you guys are literally gonna like cut a fucking saucer and give out a saucer, because I would fucking cream my pants. Like,
did you cream your pants?
Did you reach completion?
I wished.
Oh
no. Dude, you know how hard it would be to actually find a metal saucer nowadays? That'd be fucking awesome.
Yeah, shine her up real good boy.
Robert told you crackers about to tan.
Chad, are we done with notes?
Let's see. That's really about it. I just have, like, you know, unlike in other movies, like The First Victim's a dog, where they usually don't kill dogs.
And Michael Myers kills dogs. Jason does not.
It kills dogs. I will throw a couple notes on top of Chad's then.
Okay, throw them on me.
Bill Goldberg actually met his wife on this movie.
Really?
Yeah, I remember you telling me that.
Yep. So in the titty bar scene. The girl where he jumped up on the swing and had his face in her snatch.
Okay.
Really?
That's how he met his wife.
That's hilarious. Yeah. That's
Mrs. Goldberg.
That is a story to tell. How'd you meet your wife? Well, let me tell you a story, son.
We were filming a movie. And
I got to play Santa, and my wife was playing a stripper. And that.
And I shoved my face in her crotch.
And the rest was history.
Man, it was history. That's how you were made.
That's fucking epic.
That's awesome.
And then I guess they filmed in like 28 days, and there was like a couple nights where Bill Goldberg actually stayed in the little town where they filmed, and he like stayed at a local bar and just signed everybody's shit, whatever they wanted him to sign. Like, so that was probably pretty awesome for them, I'd imagine. That was pretty nice of him too, to just fucking chill out, because what the fuck else, man? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
What else is he going to do?
Absolutely. But so if we're going to skip all that shit, let's get to these. Now, this movie was kind of hard to make some questions for.
Yes.
Just because.
Pretty cut and dry story. Not familiar.
Yeah, it's like, you know,
there is no why did they do this? What was this? There is no.
Yeah. Right. Like, besides digging way too fucking deep.
And we don't do that on this show.
DJ's just going to pee-pee slap me for.
I'll smack that pecker, boy.
Fucking right. So I will ask a few questions that, you know, at least get hopefully a laugh on you guys. So in the beginning, why did the girl ask to not be Samoan?
I think it was just the dumbest thing that they could think of.
What's a Samoan?
Like, I like it. Even Chris Kattan mouths that. He's like, Samoan.
I think it was just like the dumbest thing that anybody could ever be prejudiced against. That's why they just threw it in there.
Yeah.
I mean, that's this whole movie, though.
You want to know why they knew someone in the future would ask this question. That's why.
It's so, dude, like, that's what I'm saying. Like, this movie is really hard to make questions for because it's just so, like, just parody and just stupid slapstick. And it's like, I don't know, man. But, it's
almost perfect.
Okay, so here you go. I'll ask you guys,
Bobby, quit playing with your toys, damn it.
Damn it, Bobby. So there was a lot of like background shit and everything like that. But so when the kid came to the police station and the lobby cop, where he had the whole cock versus Bush debate.
Yes.
Did you guys catch the officer's name?
Yes, I did. And I asked my wife if she noticed it.
You did?
Dick Zucker.
Yep. I was like, I had to write that down.
I was hoping somebody else would notice that. Yes, I did see that.
There's so many good things like that. And that's just stupid, dumb bullshit. Like just eighth grade humor. And I love it. Let's see here. You know, honestly. Okay. So do you know, or did you guys recognize, or do you remember the name of the Santa tracker?
No.
Gonad.
Yep.
I saw that too.
Gonad.
I had to think for a second. Yep, it was Gonad.
It stands for Global Expectations for Aerospace Defense.
Oh, okay.
Or Global Operations. I don't know. Apparently this was like it was a ripoff of like a new an actual thing, like Nomad or something like
NORAD.
That.
That's
the NORAD. Yeah, NORAD. Yeah, that's what it is.
Yeah.
They try to find the aliens.
But now it's just a Santa tracker.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's some really great dick jokes in this.
The last question was, what if you guys can remember, what was the name of the Christmas Super Bowl? Who hosted it?
Who the fuck would remember that shit?
Chad might, because he remembered the fucking Dick Zucker and the other one.
I remember Dick Zucker.
Super Bowl. I don't remember.
So it was like when he first sat down and he was like eating his sandwich, like when he got his grandpa's home, and he was just turned on the TV and it was. So he goes, it says, stay tuned for the hornyasianhotwives.com Christmas Super Bowl. Dude, this movie is just. Filled with just tons of that dumb shit.
This filthy dumb shit. It's wonderful.
And you know what? One of my best. That's it for questions. I have really no fucking questions for this movie. Like, but there's one thing straight up 2005, and I love that it was in there, was this little bad boy.
Yeah, the circle game. Hell yeah.
Yeah, the fucking circle game, dude.
I love that because when I worked at FLIR, me and a bunch of my coworkers are always trying to get each other with that. We still do it. Every once in a while, we'll tag each other on Facebook about something like that. And I saw that, and I just looked over at my wife, and she's like, no.
No!
When you saw him first do it, did you yell at the screen? Because I did, because I was like, that's above the waist. That doesn't count.
That's above the waist. You fucking
There's rules of that shit.
But he did get her at the end.
He did. And I'm so glad that was that stayed with the fucking stayed with us. Oh man, no, dude, this, you know, like if you're looking for, I'm always personally looking for Christmas comedies, man. Like those are my favorite Christmas movies. Like I said, this one's going in rotation for me, man, especially definitely, with the slasher aspect of it. Like, oh my god.
this might Happy actually Hanukkah. Be worth tracking down a Blu-ray for.
Oh yeah,
right.
Happy Hanukkah.
The fucking menorah right in the neck.
Oh.
So you know what? I'm gonna ask you, gentlemen, who the fuck are you gonna choose for douche of the movie?
Santa.
For this movie.
Santa Claus is a fucking dick.
But I mean, he's the immaculate son of Satan, so he's just kind
of
like.
I think the only real douche of the movie was the preacher.
Mm.
Okay.
because of how, you know, corrupt he was. You know, he was taking the fucking collection money and wasting it on strippers. That's why he told them they wanted dollar bills.
I mean, yeah, he eventually got his comeuppance. With a fucking llama ripoff camel rocket launcher.
By the way, how hilarious was their quote unquote reindeer, which is really just a fucking buffalo?
Well, they called it a killdeer, I believe. So
yeah,
but something like that. Hey man, even that had a kill. It ate the fucking valet.
Yeah, it so, did. You know. Yeah, and it killed Grandpa.
And yeah.
Oh yeah, ran him over.
Double kill. So
dude.
Who's the douche? Anybody? Do we have a collective douche, or just
I still say the preacher.
Okay.
Yeah, the preacher. I can't say Santa's the douche. I loved it too much.
I was gonna say Mrs. Talbot, the old lady in the beginning, but she's
she was so funny. That was hilarious.
She was a bitch, but
it's Christmas. I wish you Merry Christmas.
Move, bitch! Okay, get out of the way.
Merry Christmas. Thanks. And fuck you.
Such a nice old lady.
Dude. This movie fucking... I don't know. Like, I'm going to probably have to go with Chad. Because he honestly was like the longest lasting douche of the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just love how he's sitting there. All you strippers are around him. Yeah, thank you, honey. Merry Christmas. So, let me know.
I will say the main kid, though, he was kind of douchey in his own right.
Yeah.
Because, like...
He was douchey stupid.
Well, by the end, like, he was still, like, doubting his grandpa. It's like, bro,
hey, your grandpa's
already know what Santa's
angel.
Doing. Your grandpa's already built a bunker. Just fucking listen to him at this point. You know what I mean? Like,
you want to know what I hated about him, too, is at first I didn't think he knew, like, the girl liked him. Turns out they were in a relationship. Like, dude.
Yeah, it just seemed like they were just co-workers and then friends.
You were just mad that she was wasted on an asshole like him.
Yeah, it's like, what the fuck?
But by the way, I just wanted to add, I was sitting there thinking after the movie was over, I was like, you know, I think this is one of the first movies where it looks like, it seems like the teenagers actually played by teenagers. I looked up and the girl was like in her fucking 20s when she made this.
Yeah, she was in Lost, dude. She was already in her second season of Lost when she fucking made this. Like, I know I watched that fucking show and I hate it and blah, blah, blah. I'm not even going down that road. But how old was the kid? Was he in his 20s too?
I don't know. I didn't look that up.
Oh,
she was older, I'm like, whatever.
I mean, they played the part well.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they did.
But
I got a huge kick out of the line, and I won't repeat it because I know the word offends TJ. But when she gave him the transformer gun for the gift,
yes,
I was like, I want to seem ungrateful.
Oh.
I like when
dated joke.
When Santa saw it, or when
when he got it and he looked at her and said, "Are you fucking?"
Oh yeah, I laughed my ass off.
Yep.
But then what did he say when Santa saw the gun?
I gave this to whatever his name.
Blah, 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 in 86.
1983.
Queer.
Exactly. Queer.
But yo, man, side note on that. That motherfucker is stupid as fuck because that girl, that's where you wife her, man. She knows guns. She's into you. She's hot.
Yeah, she was really
cute. She buys you nerdy shit on Christmas Eve, like, which is super and super rare nerdy shit, by the way. Like,
any man or woman that does that for each other, wife them up and marry them.
Oh yeah, she was super cute.
But the movie is Go to the Pastor. So let's go to
the questions. Chill.
Go to the questions. I'm going to go get a drink. Chad, get the questions. Favorite kill. I'm going to say mine was the thing in the throat.
The menorah?
The thing in the
menorah
throat?
In the throat.
Oh, gotcha. The thing in the throat.
I know Bobby said his before we started recording, and I'm actually going to completely agree with him because that was the one I was going to go with, and that was the death by the electrified stripper pole.
Makes me look at stripper poles in a whole different way.
And what was really funny was when Santa Claus freaking wiped it down and sanitized it before he even touched it.
Yes, the fact that he went like this beforehand. Ugh. Yes. And fucking sprays that shit. I'm just like, that's like, this reminds me of when me and my buddies went because we saw the girls do that. It's like, really that dirty?
You got to disinfect.
Oh, wait a minute. I thought about that for a second.
Oh, dude, that was that whole scene was great.
We'll go, I'll go about that when we get to the favorite.
Oh, yeah, part. Definitely.
No, man, I mean, you know, I want to say that too because that was just it was a good kill. It was just
it was never inventive. Would have thought about it, you know?
No, yeah. It was inventive. And then just the way the dude looked at the end of it was fucking sweet too.
Yeah,
like, oh man, dude, it's there's. There's 40 fucking deaths in this movie. there's a lot of kills to choose from, man. Like,
never enough kills. There's never enough kills to choose from.
Like, I don't even know. There's so many good ones. I probably.
What do you mean? Just pick one. Just be like, okay, this one was pretty cool.
Johnny, you're starting to sound like me at a buffet. Pick something.
Yes, come on.
Yeah, hurry, don't be like hurry, me and pick everything it. And eat it do all it. And go back for seconds.
Fine. Do it. You know what? I'm going to have to say when he finally burns down the strippers, just because he quotes Silent Night, Deadly Night and says, naughty. And fucking throws the coal. So
are we we're recording or no?
Yeah, we're recording.
Oh, I didn't know if we were or not.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't we not be recording?
Well, TJ went away for a second.
He just went out to get a freaking bottle of water.
How dare you?
Oh, fuck off.
Greta.
All right. So we all got our favorite kills.
That's true. So,
that's triple pull. I just can't get out of my fucking head. You don't think about it. Like, come on.
It was either that or the Fran Drescher death just because it's Fran Drescher.
Who drinks that much fucking eggnog, by the way, dude? There's six of them. They had like 3 gallons of eggnog.
Well, to be fair, it seemed like they all hated each other, so maybe they just all needed eggnog to get through the night.
Right. Well, they had money, obviously, that they were just wiping their asses with. Oh, what a great scene.
Okay,
that
so
was
we're up to best scene.
Woo!
Gentlemen, best scene.
My best scene was the whole snowmobile chase at the end, dude, with the exploding box presents.
Oh, that was wonderful.
Because I love the random just punk ska fucking Santa music in the background. And it was just, it was so ridiculous. But I laughed the whole fucking. Bobby, what you got, bud?
Favorite scene. Oh, my God. I would have to probably go with the strip club scene, just how he walks in and he grabs someone, stripper starts kissing her. She's like, ugh, and he just points up and there's a mistletoe. There. He's got this look on his face like, I obeyed the rules.
Yeah, but,
that whole scene.
But the bouncer still go after him for it.
Yeah. Bill Goldberg was wonderful in that. I love
it. Fucks that guy up so bad. Mm-hmm. Also, why do we only get one spear? I'm kind of like,
but it was epic spear. It was through the fucking deli counter.
Right. He speared another Jewish guy through the deli counter. Perfect. Yeah. I mean, he couldn't be doing it. You had to only get one. That's all. You know what I mean?
Like, you only need one.
It's all you need.
One is all you need.
One is all you need.
We're going back to. I'm going to agree with Bobby. I agree with him. The strip club scene, especially the scene where he's taking down the guys with a fucking table.
Yeah, that was pretty sweet. I felt like there was a lot of missed opportunities for one-liners, though.
Yeah, I kind of thought that, too.
Like, table for two? Like, he could have slammed
that. Yeah, he could have done that.
I didn't think about that. That would have been perfect. Too, that would have made that scene even more perfect.
Like, I mean, they had a few of them, but they just, you know.
There were some missed opportunities.
Okay, yeah, missed opportunity number one is, you do an unveiling of a candy cane lightsaber, but then they don't fucking do anything with it. Like, I was like, come on, give me a kill with that, dude. Just for whatever.
I think another missed opportunity was the overuse of tassels in the strip club scene.
Yes, we could have had much more, plenty more nipple.
Yes.
We need nipple, people.
Yeah. Yeah.
They had to silently contemplate that for a few seconds.
You know, the pause actually added to the comedic timing of that, and I'm very proud of you boys. I'm very proud of you. That was excellent. So moving on from nipple tassels in much more, my favorite scene, since I didn't really give that, would be the opening scene for me. Because it's just
which is Yeah, perfect segue.
Boom.
Okay, and you just answered the next question.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah, perfect segue.
Fucker hooked me in real good.
Yes, it did. Oh, what a great opening scene.
It was, man. Like, there's so many big names right off the bat, and you're like, holy shit, dude. And what a... Listen, man, if you thought the families in, like, Krampus were bad, this family makes them look fucking great.
Oh, no, yeah, doubt. I love this family. Yes.
What was it? Was Chris Kattan the son? I was trying to figure it out because they all had the same last name. And wait a minute. So is he the son, and that's got to be, like, his stepmom?
That has
Fran
to
Drescher,
be.
Which,
yeah.
Side note, Fran Drescher.
Franny!
Just,
Horrible voice, hot chick.
I can get totally past the voice, dude. Like, I don't know, it kind of does.
Hey, man, no, whatever, dude. No comment.
Oh, Bobby too, then.
No comment.
Yeah, Bobby.
Oh, you're killing me.
So, yeah, the opening scene definitely hooks us in.
Dude, it was perfect. And I forgot,
James
Caan
is the father, man.
You What's that?
James Caan playing the father.
TJ's dude, over here. Caan! When I saw him in the movie, I'm like, how the fuck did they get him in?
So
how the fuck did they get him to do this?
I had a blank for a second. For a second, I thought it was Jeffrey Rush still playing his, like, Vincent Price character from fucking
House on Haunted Hill.
Because that was, like, Chris Kattan, and I saw...
That would have been great if they would have just used the whole House on Haunted Hill cast for that scene.
Oh, yeah, right. I mean... Dude, just the way he comes in, does the fucking barrel, like the fucking barrel roll, and
roll.
The Christmas ninja. Once again, missed opportunities for perfect one line.
We needed more wrestlers in this movie as well. I needed more WCW wrestlers.
See, that's where we need the second Santa sleigh.
They could all be like his one-off people or something.
Dude, like Kevin Nash would be the Abominable Snowman.
Perfect. Oh yes, come on. Dude, he can still do it.
Scott Hall can be drunk Krampus. The relapse.
Would Hogan be his dad?
Hey, brother.
The Hurricane could be Jack Frost.
Oh, that's so
great. Sugar Shane Helms. Okay, moving on. Moving on.
Moving on to our
best
favorite.
Tits, best tits, hottest girl.
Yeah.
Anyone in that strip club scene?
Anyone in the titty bar.
We ain't going to be picky about boobies this time.
Yeah.
Why can't we be picky with the boobies?
There's so many to choose from. It was like a boobie
options
buffet.
Options.
It was like, do you want a bunch of no-name boobies like a buffet, or do you want like actress boobies like Fran Drescher's or something like that where you're only going to get like one set? You know what? I'm going to go TJ. I'm going to go buffet of boobies. Titty bar.
It's like comparing calzones and strombolis.
Exactly.
We are not going to do this again.
By the way, for our listeners, 2 weeks later, the discussion is still ongoing.
By the way, for our listeners, you still got to put the fucking regatta, no matter what fucking stromboli or calzone.
Heather says it's all about the roll of the dough.
It's correct.
It don't matter what you're eating as long as it tastes fucking good. Moving on, buffet of boobies. Go on.
Buffet of boobies.
Damn it, John.
As long as it tastes good.
That's what she said. Anyway.
Wait. Was he talking about the ricotta cheese, or were we talking about the buffet of boobies again?
Boobies.
Okay. Did the score set the mood?
Yes, because it was just as cheesy as the movie it was supposed to be.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Just the fucking Christmas pop
punk bullshit, dude.
Best song. What's the best song?
Christmas in Detroit.
Yeah, Christmas in Detroit.
We will all agree on that one. This movie, we all like it. This is garbage. We need to disagree on something. Bobby, argue that it's scary, okay? Promise me. Okay. Thank you. Favorite character, mine would have to be. Shit's gonna get dirty in the next question. Favorite
just
character.
You wait.
My favorite character would have to be.
I know mine.
While he thinks about it, I'm gonna say my favorite character was Santa.
Yeah,
Santa. There is no debate. Yeah, it's Santa. Get the fuck out. It's Santa.
Really?
Goldberg is fantastically over the top as the evil Santa. Come on.
I have a
naughty.
I kind of have a, I'm going to say like three. Bill Goldberg, obviously. I love Dave Thomas, dude. So I got to give it because he was awesome as Pastor.
The grandpa is excellent.
And then the grandpa. Yeah. The grandpa's.
Oh, yeah. Great. Okay. Yeah.
He, he kind of reminds me of the grandpa from Terror Vision.
Listen,
I'll say grandpa too because he was good.
Listen, okay, he's a great grandpa because he actually crap dusted his grandson just like all grandpas should.
Yeah, that's true. He did.
I said sorry.
Okay, so TJ, you just mentioned Terrorvision. Does that mean you watched Terrorvision and The Video Dead?
I didn't watch The Video Dead. I didn't watch that garbage fucking heap show.
Oh, dude, it's terrible.
It is terrible. But you have to watch it just so you see what we mean.
The only real horror movies I watched this week were Freddy vs. Jason and Nightmare on Elm Street 3.
Ah, that's a great movie.
I like them both.
You like them both.
I do.
Hey, John, did you order one of those Friday? Sidebar. Friday sidebar. Ding, 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 ding. Okay, John, did you order that Terror Thread shirt?
I did. I did not have to. All I did was tag the wife, and she said as soon as I tagged her, she ordered it for me.
Oh, okay. So I got one, too.
I don't have that kind of...
Hey, when you get one, let's take pictures, and we'll put them up on together, and you put hashtag twinning.
Aw, that's adorable.
Hell yeah. That was a little bit of a pricey shirt. I was like, whoa.
$27 plus shipping. Holy fuck. But guess what?
$29 for fat boy shirts.
So. Oh, that's right. Yeah.
I was like, ooh, $30 for a shirt.
Hefty Heidi over here takes the plus XLs.
I don't know. Anymore, that seems to be a normal price for shirts online.
It is, though. Yeah, I mean, they got to make a profit at some point. And if you're like a small distributor like that, you know, the prices are going to be higher to manufacture them. So
who was it?
Terror Threads.
It was Cavity Colors.
No. Not Cavity Colors. Terror Threads.
Because that's about how much Cavity Colors run, too.
Bobby, who's doing the part two ones right now?
That's Cavity Colors.
That's the shirt I ordered. Yep. Wrong shirt.
Yeah, we got the Versus shirt, dude.
Forget how much me and John love the New Line movies.
I do, man. Like, I know they get shit on, but Jason X and Versus, dude.
I'd rather watch those three than any of the other films repeatedly.
No.
I think they're more entertaining, and the nostalgia factor just punches me in the dick. And I like being punched in the dick.
Jason X and Jason Goes to Hell are my two favorite New Line ones. Though I still haven't gotten my...
I can watch part six any day.
Jason Goes to Hell
pendant
one. I still haven't gotten my pendant yet either.
Motherfucker, hold on!
Oh, so gentlemen, even though this movie just came out in like 2005, does it hold up today?
Absolutely.
Yeah, it does.
Come on.
I would say...
That's not a question.
Better than most Christmas movies, I would say.
Not Silent Night, Deadly Night 2.
Oh, that's a timeless classic, dude.
Timeless classic.
I saw that on Amazon last night. That's like Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. I almost watched that because I'm not going to lie, dude. This movie was so good. I was ready to watch it again last night.
Behind that poster, and I have a Silent Night poster.
And so I was scrolling through Amazon and then I saw Silent Night, Deadly Night 2. And I was like, let's watch something I haven't watched. But we'll get to that in a little bit.
We'll get to that in a little bit.
A little post-show discussion,
But okay, so gentlemen, acting.
Good or bad?
Superb.
I want to say bad.
Classy.
But it was intentionally bad, so that makes it good.
Correct. Like, I would feel like, okay, everybody knows this movie is quote-unquote bad. But I feel like if you come out generally, like Bobby said, I had a smile on my face the whole fucking time.
Yeah.
So I feel like if you leave this movie entertained, man, then it was actually a good movie overall.
Oh, yeah,
like,
definitely.
Yeah. Like they knew what they were doing. They were just like, listen, man, we're going to have Bill Goldberg as Santa. This is going to be fucking ridiculous and over the top. Let's just fucking do it. But they got some good names in there, too. They even had, I got to make it a little honorable mention. They had fucking Debo in there, dude. Randomly enough for no fucking reason. Nobody knows who Debo is.
Fuck.
Nobody watched Friday?
No.
Oh,
damn.
Okay.
You mean Tiny.
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 I know.
Lister.
I was just like, well, I said Debo because he said he's like,
yeah,
no, man, I had to get out of this.
He steals the bikes. Fuck. He steals the bikes. Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Oh, fuck, dude. So, yeah, acting. I would say, like Chad said, man, for what it was, you know, it's... It was intentionally bad, so it was good.
Yeah.
What do we got next, gentlemen?
Cinematography. Okay. Okay, so get prepared for the most in-depth look ever into this film. So,
all right,
see, buckled up, daddy. Let's do this.
You see here, you can so fucking tell that this was filmed really low budget and made directly for fucking DVD. This movie has no redeemable qualities when it comes to production value, has no redeemable qualities when it comes to art or artistic value. This movie was filmed for the entire point of seeing fucking Bill Goldberg dressed as Santa killing things with comedy sprinkled in here like beautiful rainbow sprinkles. Oh, God.
Pretty fucking much.
sums it up.
But yeah, there is nothing about this that's like, fuck, that was a good shot, or damn, the lighting was just impeccable. So do you like the cinematography? Absolutely fucking not. But the movie was entertaining as hell. That is all.
Yeah, well said.
I can go with that. I like that. The only thing I could say for cinematography is I'll give them props for when they did the actual flying scenes. Mm-hmm. Because they did use a real bull. They had to make
a real bull. Is that a water buffalo?
Or a buffalo.
Do we know the species?
What? The hell deer. Yes.
The hell deer. So that doesn't answer the species question. You know what? I'm looking up water buffaloes. You keep going.
Oh, yeah. So they actually had to make a rig to fucking hoist that motherfucker up, but they could only do it in 30-second shots. So every time they did it, so they had to do like super 360 shots of him doing it, like, and they had to do it multiple times throughout the day and stuff like that. So while they didn't give us necessarily anything like inventive or anything, I will say that that's mad props for coming up with shit like that.
Is that what it is, though?
Yeah, I think so.
What's that? Do we got it?
He's got pictures of a bison. I think that's what it is.
Is it a bison?
It's an American bison.
Bison.
Yep.
Ooh.
Yeah, boy. We got the species on lockdown. Yeah. Hold on. I got to break out my phone for the calculator. We're getting close. Okay.
Yo, should we end this with fucking move, bitch?
Okay. Anyway, premise, yes. premise.
Oh, yeah. Great premise.
Actually, this is
evil Santa.
This was kind of an original take on an evil Santa, which I liked the fact that it was an immaculate conception of the devil. I can't say I've ever seen any other movie like that. That I was just like, huh, that's interesting.
Everybody. And, Robert. What was that? Robert.
Yes.
Premise.
I loved it.
Okay.
I loved it.
What do you like better? Do you like Krampus or do you like Bill Goldberg Santa?
Really?
Who could win a fight, Bobby?
Bill Goldberg, come on. Because his smart assness would just win it, over.
Yeah, Goldberg would just spear Krampus and it'd be over.
He'd be like, I would hope he would break his horns off and like.
He'd like spear him. Who's next?
Wait. And then we need Santa Slay versus Krampus movie. That's our sequel with more wrestling. Dude, there it is right there. Gold. Done.
Okay. Everybody likes the premise. Rating, motherfuckers.
Well, nice.
I'm going to give it a 4.5.
I'm also going to give it a 4.5.
Okay, Bobby?
Yeah. I said 4.0.
I'm going to give it 4.25. I'd go 4.5, but all the tassels pissed me off.
That's fair.
4.3.
You went 4.75?
Yeah.
I would have went 5.0.
5.0. It would have been a perfect 5 if we saw
Gore N More score of 4.3 out of 5 for 2005's Santa's Sleigh featuring the WCW champion Bill Goldberg.
Very respectable.
Naughty.
Naughty. Who's your daddy?
Fuck.
What was the other? Oh my God. There was another good. Where they shine the light in him. He's like, I'm Santa Claus, not
fucking Dracula.
I love it. And then the Jewish guy, he was like holding the little fucking Star of David at him like it was gonna fucking do.
Hey, it worked in the mummy.
Right? Yeah. Oh, when he was going through like all the little Yeah, it's true. That dude was a douchebag, man. He played such a good douche in that.
With such a great, amazing douche, just memorable as all hell.
So now that we're through Santa's sleigh, I'd like to bring up actually another Christmas movie, which we've talked about before. And I actually got to, we'll bring that up too. I actually finally watched fully Rare Exports.
Yes, I watched bits and pieces of that as well. It's fucked up, dude.
And without going too in depth, because there's a good chance we could cover it next year. It was good. I wanted more because it was so good. Like, I wish it gave me a little bit more. But obviously, you know, budgetary constraints and blah, blah, blah. A lot of subtitles, but that doesn't bother me. So as long as you're cool with that. But what I like about it is, even with most of these Christmas horror movies, there's still a little bit of like dark humor in there. Even with Krampus, yep. Like there's, it wasn't, obviously Krampus wasn't as funny as Santa's sleigh, but it still had its moments where you're going to like laugh out loud. Not this movie, dude. This movie is like straight up dark, serious, and it's fucking, it's an awesome take on it. Yeah. Like a whole killer dark Santa. So that's all I want to say on that. I know Bobby's friend, Rain, has mentioned it before that she would like us
Rain!
To cover it as well.
Rain! How the fuck do you say her last name?
Bobby?
Hold on. Wait a minute. Wait a minute.
Is it?
Fel Walker. That's it. Fel Walker.
Okay. Okay. All right.
Just like Grandpa Fel with his walker, you know?
Ah! My hip! Okay.
So... moving off of this Christmas stuff, I
go for it, Johnny. Anybody let's that, go. Let's go.
Anybody that's listened to previous podcasts knows that I'm a huge fucking Ghostbuster nerd. I'm part of a cosplay group, blah, blah, blah. Gentlemen, thoughts on the trailer?
It looked fucking great. I'm genuinely excited for this one. Big time.
So, Chad?
Yeah. I mean, I was a huge fan when the first one first came out, and it's something my kids love, and I think that this is definitely something I'll be able to take my kids to, and it looks fun. Yeah. I just really hope that we still get some of the original's dick humor.
Yes.
Okay. There is a lot of it in the first one, not so much the second one.
But I was thinking about this last night, and the fact that they're going with teenagers, I thought, you know, they might shy away from that. But then I thought, you know, The Goonies was also a lot like that. So if they keep it kind of close to The Goonies, they can still use the same kind of humor.
Bingo. And you also got to remember, this is a different time and age for films like this. Look at It for the kids and the way that they were talking and the way that they were acting. I think a lot of films like this, you know, you really don't know what to expect. Look at the movie Good Boys. It's a lot, you know, it's kids with being an adult humor. So don't let it pass. We could see anything. And remember, these are the kids of Ghostbusters. Right. At least one of them we know is confirmed. And then we don't know where the legends come in the play here. And I mean, it's been 30 years after the fact. So a lot. And the trailer is actually a good trailer because it doesn't really give up much other than,
yes, it does.
Okay. For the casual, for the fucking casual, and not the guy that beats his dick to Ghostbusters comics over here that knows all the lore.
Don't be judging. I'm one of them too.
Like, okay, so obviously there's still not things 100% confirmed, but obviously this trailer was definitely a good homage to Harold Ramis. It was based around Spangler. Like, they didn't really, they showed Aykroyd and, Murray, at least from the actual original one, which I personally love that they just pulled it up on like YouTube. He's just like, yeah, who doesn't fucking love Paul Rudd?
I think my
fan theory on in it, I think he might be the new Keymaster. That's what I'm hoping for. I don't know.
So you're thinking
the return of Zool.
So you're thinking that it's Gozer.
Well, I thought
I've read rumors that
99% sure that's a fucking terror dog on his hood.
That's what I was thinking too.
Getting chased by a terror dog, that means it's through. And here's the other thing: it's okay. So they're all on a village of Shandor. Anybody? And I'm going to go fucking soul Ghostbuster nerd in like 2 seconds.
Five, four,
wait,
three.
Wait. Go back to the village of Shandor. That's the name of the place.
No. Okay, so anybody who's watched the first movie, if is. Shandor rings a bell, Shandor yes. is the architect who built Dana Barrett's building.
Yeah.
He's the one who created the cult of Gozer and like wanted to bring Gozer into the world.
And he's also the villain of the video game.
Yes.
Correct. Who's actually like, I'm kind of hoping they go that route. I hope he like uses Gozer, but like he uses Gozer for himself to make himself like that much more of like a stronger enemy.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a whole town that he's built. So okay, I didn't even know that.
So that's pretty. That's
right. So the whole mining company, it's all Shandor. So you have idea what's going to be on this fucking town, of why it's shaking and shit like that. So now there's other theories that Egon has a containment unit ruptured down there. Like there's so fucking potential many. But the fact of the matter is it's a Shandor town.
Yeah.
And he caused the events of Ghostbusters 1 with just a couple fucking buildings. So what could he do with a whole, like, dude, I don't know.
The whole town. No, go ahead,
John.
Go. Well, what I was going to say, I mean, I'm a huge Ghostbusters fan. I mean, the first two, people give the crap to the second one, but it was still a great movie. So when I saw 2016, I wasn't really thrilled with it. I actually didn't even see it. I saw 2 minutes of it, and I was like, this is enough. So, but when I saw this trailer, I saw every homage to the original, to the second one, to the game. I just kept going, oh shit, what the fuck are they going to do with this? So like, and the fact that, like you were saying before, that Shandor has this town, it's all this shit's under the ground. And like, I'm like, what kind of damage is this really going to cause this time? And what is going to happen when they have to deal with this?
I'm glad you mentioned the game, because John, you brought up about the German trailer, I think it was, or the French or whatever. And they showed the very end clip that you wanted me to see was the handheld proton blaster that was from the video game.
Yeah.
What the kid was holding?
Yes.
No, that was a boom mic.
Was it?
Yes. If you look again, it's a full microphone. Like they're recording it. But yeah, it is the full Polaroid Ecto goggles, dude, which I can almost guarantee that the German Ghostbuster group, dude, they build everything. And when I say everything, like every toy line that Ghostbusters ever came out with, and all the action figures had their weird little fucking like extra toys. Yeah, these guys have made like real life versions of it.
No shit.
Awesome, dude. I don't know if you remember the old little go-kart. It was called like the Ghost Grabber, and it had
expansions
on the front.
Yeah,
yeah.
These fuckers made it last year, dude. A full go-kart, dude. Actual like movable giant.
No fucking shit.
Oh my god. Oh my god. Like, you're a Ghostbuster nerd and you check out their site, you will fucking
send me that link. Please.
Post a link in the chat.
Send me their website. See
that. I mean, not that my trap doesn't have a fucking, you know, goddamn remote control giant ghost trap.
I have
that was wicked.
I have always,
I'm so glad you showed us.
Always
that.
Wanted a proton pack. I gotta get one day.
Well, you know someone who knows how to build them. So
yeah, Johnny, help me out, please.
I will
pay you.
And you know what I will say also with this trailer, and not to go far down this hole, but the one thing everybody's on board with this one is that it at least acknowledges the original franchise. 16 probably could have been a lot better had the director and certain actors in the movie handled the PR better with the movie.
Yes.
Instead of just straight out calling people out and backlashing and saying, well, you're this if you don't go see the movie. No, fuck off. That you made something nobody wanted to see. You can't be mad at them if they're not fucking, they don't want to see it. Whereas like this one, you know, I mean, it's done by fucking Ivan Reitman's son.
Yeah.
Jason. So like, it's going to be a pure fucking
Ghostbusters sequel.
Yeah. It's going to be a love letter essentially, dude. Like for real. And
ode.
The whole thing with the kids, supposedly Aykroyd and his fucking craziness. He said Sony wants to do 6 sequels. Well, as much as we love the old farts, they're not going to fucking make it 6 sequels. You got to kind of go with a young crew. So I get it.
I worry about the fans getting kind of bored with 6 sequels.
I'd do a trilogy and do it like Star Wars style.
I think they should have. I was hoping for like, honestly, like a Netflix series or something, dude. Like I would have went even that route.
Not only that, with six sequels, you're not getting Bill Murray back for another one, I guarantee.
That's what I'm saying. You're going to get the old guys. You're going to get Murray for this one. I'm going to call it Murray's going to die at the end of this one.
Yeah, because that's what he wants. That's what he's wanted all
along. He's always said that, dude, for the last 30
years. Yeah, well, they also said recently, like, he was done filming anyway, so his filming was not long.
Dude, if somehow they sneak in Moranis and they pull him out, I might cry a little.
I'm not going to lie.
Because, like, the fact that he hasn't done shit in fucking forever.
I liked the original, for the Ghostbusters 3 script that was out there, and I guess the final scene would have been all the Ghostbusters dead, they're ghosts, and they're sitting there playing cards. I think that would be...
Ghostbusters go to hell?
Something. Yeah.
No, it was Hellbent.
That's it, Hellbent. That's it. Yeah.
But yeah, I think that would be the proper way to include Ramis.
Aykroyd's been wanting to do like them go to hell for so long.
Well, yeah, with just budgetary constraints.
Well,
CGI.
I mean, you know his original design for Ghostbusters 2, right?
Bro, like, his original design for Ghostbusters, dude. It was
the original Ghostbusters was way darker. The second one was just as crazy as the original. Was like, wait a minute, what the fuck is he trying to do?
The first one, he wanted the car to be all purple lights, and he wanted it to fly and be able to like transmorph into other things.
Yeah, they were supposed to travel dimensions.
Yeah,
it over the place.
Fucking crazy, dude. That's why they brought Harold Ramis in. They're like, listen, we're gonna smoke this weed instead, and we're gonna pull it back a little bit more.
But I'm willing to tell you right now, if John Belushi did not die, you would have gotten Ghost Smashers. And not Ghostbusters. I have a feeling that would have been a little more prominent.
And I'm kind of also glad like Chevy Chase turned it down too, because like as much as I love Chevy Chase,
he wouldn't have fit the role.
No,
it just would have not been the same.
No,
but no, man, I'm glad. I'm just happy for the super positive feedback, minus the few random fucking bullshit social justice warriors that are crying that
it's because people suck.
Don't forget about 16. No, 16 was a flop.
Can we talk about Black Christmas completely bombing?
Yes.
Yeah, it did.
Let's do that.
I'm not surprised. I'm
As really not. I am a huge fan of 1974's Black Christmas, and it is
that's the only one we should ever have to worry about.
One of the first slasher films, and Billy is iconic killer.
Which,
and,
by the way, that's our next movie.
Yes.
Next week.
It was remade in what, 2006?
2009. I think
it was 5 or whatever.
I think it was 2009.
It was in 2009, and it was atrocious.
And then remade it with a completely different story, so they really shouldn't even have called this Black Christmas. And it completely and totally bombed at the box office. We started realizing this whenever the poor reviews started coming in early, and then people started taking pictures of empty theaters. And it's just never really good. It's just never really good when that happens. And I guess the film was made with a PG-13 rating in mind and with a feminist agenda purposely put in the story to promote this thing. Now here, personally, I'm going to put my opinion into this, and I normally don't do this, but here we go. I think it's more empowering for a woman to survive all of her friends dying and then overcome that oppressor herself rather than having a bunch of her friends gang up with her and then taking them the fight to that person. That's just my opinion. But then again, to each his own. But to call this a Black Christmas film and to call this a slasher film and not like a revenge film to like I Spit on Her Grave, I think that would be more accurate.
Dude, I figure like this could have been like, and I know Sorority Row is already like a fucking slasher, but like that title would have been a better title.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, that would have been
fucking Black. I don't know.
But they got to cash in. You know, they own the rights to that franchise, so they got to cash in and use that name. And if you use that name, then there's that recognition amongst horror fans. And then horror fans will create buzz on the internet, which will get other people interested in the film. That's what happens, whether that be positive or negative. PR is PR, you know what I mean? So the problem is that the film's fucking garbage and nobody went to go see it because all the negative backlash and the fucking trailer revealed all the good parts of the movie. Blumhouse, you fucking suck. You fucking are garbage in Michael Myers films.
Yep.
Don't let Danny McBride write your fucking Halloween films. Okay. Kenny Powers, let me Kenny Powers be Kenny Powers.
I was gonna say, I loved, and we love Danny McBride.
Yes.
Don't get us wrong, but please don't touch Halloween.
Haunt was good. Haunt was great.
Haunt was,
yeah. Haunt was badass.
Now, anything other than that that I've seen from them, Thriller or anything that else came out this year, complete fucking garbage.
Yeah, I can't think of any other ones that I've really seen that came out this year.
What? Modern horror fucking sucks with the occasional, That's why we tend to stick to these older films, because that's where the, you know, the good, the gems and lost gems are, especially some of these ones that we are finding.
Definitely.
I mean, the direct-to-video, and then I'm really into the overseas stuff, so it's really cool. I mean, look, we watched Pieces and Don't Open Till Christmas. Those were foreign films.
Oh, they were great.
And they were
amazing. Oh, actually, speaking of foreign horror, I did watch another one this week. I watched The Ritual on Netflix.
Oh.
How was that?
It was interesting, and I liked it. I think it's like a PG-13, or I don't know how they fucking rated on there. It didn't really seem so much like an R, but I love the effects in it and everything, dude. Like, I thought it was cool. It had some, there was some awesome scenes. Like, there was one, so everybody goes through like a weird, like, mind fuck scene.
Ooh.
And this one, and obviously they're all in the woods, blah, blah, blah. But there's one part where, like, this one guy goes back to, like, something bad that's happened to him, and it was, like, in a convenience store or some bullshit. And it was cool because in one part, they combined it so where it was, like, the convenience store was actually, like, melding with the woods. Uh-huh. And just, those couple of shots just fucking looked awesome. Like, you see, like, the leaves and the sticks and everything, like, going over, like, the linoleum, and then just perfectly, like, goes into the fucking convenience store and shit. But it was an interesting, I think it was Norwegian. I'm not mistaken, which also was fucking Rare Exports, which, wow, what an ending.
I don't even know what to do in Norwegian voice, so I'm stuck. I can't even make a shitty joke.
Yeah, I got nothing on that.
No.
But no, man, I would suggest checking out. It was interesting.
All right. I'll have to check it out, though.
There was also, what's the movie coming out? Antlers. Have you guys seen that?
Guillermo del Toro.
No.
Guillermo
del Toro, Antlers.
I wonder if it's a take on like the Wendigo or the Wendigo. Probably. I don't know. It looks interesting.
Go on, Bloody Disgusting. I'm sure they have something.
Oh, I'm sure. But
by the way, how great was that review I shared for you guys the other day?
Black Christmas Day. Fucking shitting on it. It is fucking garbage. Hey. It is what it is. So there is a I'm going to end this episode with a cover by Heavy Metal Heroes of Ghostbusters. Ooh. Made 2 months ago.
Oh, go for it.
We don't own this song.
Man, that club was lame.
It's freaking Halloween. Like, Les, we need just some holiday trails or something.
All right, I don't want to just dance.
Yeah?
Let's go trick or treat.
Right, I mean, that's better than dancing.
Let's do some Ghostbuster shit.
Robbie, yeah, let's find some ghosts.
Let's go pick up Bruce and Steve.
All right, let's do it.
Let's get Bruce, Steve, we'll find some ghosts. I mean,
get it done. I mean, we gotta have a good time. You know what I'm saying?
I'm down.
Let's figure out how to win.
Who's this?
Who's this guy?
Oh, no.
I know where you guys can see some ghosts.
I'm trying to see if I recognize the echo from any specific group.